In man, there are two types of respiratory in respiratory system of man. Two things are there: respiratory tract and respiratory organs. What is the respiratory tract? That is passage which connects the atmospheric air to the respiratory organs. That is called respiratory tract. This is all respiratory tract up to this part. Okay. So, which are the respiratory tract? It consists of many organs. And no gaseous exchange takes place here. It just allows the air from the atmosphere to come to the lungs. These are the respiratory organs. These two parts. These are the lungs, which are the vital organs of human body, which is present in a thoracic cavity. Okay. Now, what are the parts of digestive tract? First of all, this is the nose. And in the nose, two openings are there. These are called nostrils. That is the first organ of the respiratory tract. Here, this is the nasal chamber. What is the present in nostril? Some hair are present over here. What is the function of those hair? They just don't allow the dirt particles to go inside. This part is slightly pink in color. A little upper part. This is vestibular part of nasal chamber. This is the next part, that is nasal chamber. And that is having a slightly pink color and some mucus is present over here. If some dust particles or allergens, they go inside, they just stick to this part. And then these are also removed manually. Then this is the, here some concha are present, external concha, some bony ridges are present over here. The function of this thing is if we go to very cold climate and very cold air that goes here. If that cold air is allowed to go through and it like that only it reaches this part, so we can have pneumonia or some lung infections can be there. So what is the function of these bony ridges? They just work like warm water bottles, hot water bottles. They just take the cold air inside and they bring it to the normal body temperature and then that air is allowed to go inside. This is nasopharynx. This is called Adam's or apple or vocal cords. It only serves as a passage of air to go from this part. This produces sound also. Then it attaches to the main organ of respiratory tract, that is called trachea. That is called windpipe also. Okay. So this is having cartilaginous rings over here. The purpose of this thing is only to check the entry of anything else rather than the air. Okay. So our organs are nostrils, nasal chambers, then pharynx. Then this is nasopharynx, nasal chamber and pharynx. When they attach together, that is called nasopharynx. Then this is larynx. And then this is the shortest and upper part of the trachea, which opens into trachea. Okay. Opening of pharynx and larynx, that is called glottis. Okay. What is the function of glottis? It always remains open. That's an opening over here to the trachea. Whenever we swallow anything, this glottis is having a flap-like structure, which is known as epiglottis. That closes temporarily just to allow the food to go to the food pipe, which is along this side only. That does not let the food particle go inside the windpipe. If it goes to trachea or windpipe, a person can die also. Okay. So this epiglottis that stops the passage of food particles to go to the windpipe. Otherwise, this epiglottis is on one side and glottis is always open to allow the air to go inside. When the air that comes here in this part, in the lungs, this is a network of tubular structures which end into sac-like structure which is called alveolus. One is alveolus and the plural of this thing is alveoli. This is the place basically where the air exchange takes place. Okay. This is very thin walled and richly supplied with the help of richly supplied with the blood vessels. It takes the carbon dioxide from the blood. I've told you in the circulatory system that pulmonary artery brings the deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle to the lungs. Na? Here it comes and then it goes out through the same passage to the outside. So how does this respiration occur? Basically, let me tell you about the lungs. These are two lungs present in a human body. That is covered by ribs on this side. we are having ribs now. That is covered by the ribs. In the center, this is chest bone, which is called sternum. And this is one lining is there and another is this. This is called pleurons, external pleurons and internal pleurons. This external pleuron and internal pleuron, there is a space which is called pleural cavity. This is filled with a fluid which is called pleural fluid. What is the function of that pleural fluid? That just prevents the lungs from any mechanical shock or any injury. Okay, that organ, these are the vital organs and these are protected by the pleural fluid. When it contracts and expands, I've already told you that all the things, they just happen. All the respiratory system, circulatory system, all the systems, they work by two things. That is relaxation and contraction. Okay, respiration also helps by these are the two main things. One is inspiration and the other is expiration. Or you can say inhalation and exhalation. Inhalation and exhalation. What is inhalation? That is taking air inside the body. How does it happen? Because when the lungs, they will have to increase the area. Okay, then what is air that is comprised of? We know that almost 21%, 20.09% of oxygen is there, 0.035% of carbon dioxide is there, and almost 78% of nitrogen is there. That we know. Okay, now the air will come as such, along with the carbon dioxide, along with nitrogen, oxygen also. That will come inside our body by means of nostrils and all the respiratory tract, and it will reach to the lungs. How? With the help of the fresh air that will enter alveoli of lungs, helped by activity of inspiratory muscles, which is called external intercostal muscles. Okay, they will expand and they will help the lungs also to expand, and the gases inside the body, there is less amount of oxygen, and the atmosphere that is having 21% of oxygen. Then the gases, they have the tendency to flow from the area of higher concentration towards the area of low concentration. When we inhale the air inside, then the air percentage inside our body is less as compared to the atmospheric air. When the muscles, they relax, the lungs also relax, and this air enters inside our body. Similarly, in the form of expiration or the exhalation, this is a relaxation of inspiratory muscles. Okay, then diaphragm, intercostal muscles and abdominal muscles, they will now contract. They will contract to throw the air outside the body. Why? Because carbon dioxide is more inside the body, in deoxygenated blood. That alveoli, they will take the carbon dioxide from the blood. And the concentration of carbon dioxide in atmospheric air is only 0.035%. So again, the gases will move from the area of higher concentration towards the area of low concentration with the help of certain muscles. That is how expiration or exhalation takes place. Okay, I think I am clear up till now. So there are certain things. It's not the thing that all of the air that will be expelled out from the from the lungs. Volume of certain air, which is normally inspired or expired with the help of each breath without any conscious effort, that is called tidal volume. Okay, this is almost 500 ml for the average adult person. And then there is certain dead air space also. Only 350 ml of this volume, that reaches the lungs. Otherwise, 150 ml remains in the digestive tract only. That is called dead air space. Then there is residual volume. Some air is left in lungs after expiration, even at the maximum, after the maximum expiration also, or forced expiration also. Some amount of air that is left in lungs, and that volume is almost 1500 ml. That is called residual volume. Okay. Then vital capacity of lung. Maximum amount of air which can be inspired or expired inside a healthy lung, that is called vital capacity of lung. Okay, this is about 3500 ml. per mole of glucose that is higher in athletes, mountain dwellers, and the young ones because they exercise more. They inhale also more oxygen and they exhale also more of carbon dioxide. So that amount, the capacity of lung is also more in them. So that is almost 4,500 milliliter. Then total lung capacity, that equals to the sum of vital capacity and residual volume. That means 3500 this one and 1500 this one. So that is total lung capacity is 5000 ml of a healthy adult man. So I think I am clear till now. Just go through this lesson. If you are having any doubts, we can have live discussion also. Or is this okay with you people? Any doubts, you can ask me anytime. Okay, thank you very much.